गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. माय टॉपिक इज डायनामिक एंड स्टैटिक प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ लंग. एक्चुअली इट इज अ कॉम्प्लेक्स, द लंग मैकेनिक्स आर अ कॉम्प्लेक्स सिस्टम, बट वी विल लुक एट इट इन शॉर्ट एंड इन इजियर वे. सो एज द नेम सजेस्ट, स्टैटिक प्रॉपर्टीज आर द लंग मैकेनिक्स विच स्टडी द लंग एंड द चेस्ट वॉल व्हेन द वॉल्यूम डज नॉट चेंज विद टाइम, एंड द डायनामिक प्रॉपर्टीज आर द लंग मैकेनिक्स विच स्टडी व्हेन द लंग एंड द चेस्ट वॉल आर इन मोशन. We will first look at the static properties, the most important being the lung compliance. And under that, we will also look shortly at the pressure-volume relationship and other aspects which maintain the alveolar stability, mainly the surfactant and the alveolar interdependence. Looking first at the lung compliance, to explain it in easier way, it's lung compliance is how much the lung is able to distend, or the elastic property of the lung. A common analogy which is drawn is that of a balloon. Usually, when you blow air into it, how well the balloon expands is actually the compliance of the balloon. The compliance is opposite to a property of the lung called the recoil or the elastic recoil, while deflation, the forces which act on it is actually the recoil. So compliance is the opposite of recoil. While inflating the lungs, property is the compliance. While it deflates is the recoil. To put it as a formal definition, is a change in the lung volume resulting from a change in the distending pressure of the lung, which is equivalent to 1 centimeter of water. This is a graph showing the transmural or the transpulmonary pressure against the volume of the lungs. And it is a curvilinear graph which shows that as the pressure increases initially, the volume of the lung increases because of the good compliance, but as the volume reaches a certain point, usually beyond the FRC, that beyond the FRC, the lung volume remains static even if the pressure increases. So this is the lung compliance. In addition to the lung compliance, is the chest wall compliance, which is also a curvilinear graph, which also plateaus below a certain pleural pressure. Transpulmonary pressure. If you put the two graphs together, we get a sigmoid curve, which is actually the compliance of the respiratory system. And this is the graph of the static compliance. This is also called the pressure volume graph. So the thing to know here is the compliance is good in a certain zone of pressure and volume, which means that during tidal volume, the compliance is the best. Beyond a certain volume, and by the time it reaches a total lung capacity, the lungs will not expand beyond that volume. And also below the residual volume, the lungs will not collapse. So this prevents infinite expansion and a total collapse of the lung. So this is the property of lung compliance. The other things that help in, so the clinical application of the static compliance is, so this is a normal curve, and this is the slope of the curve, which tells us about how much the compliance is. The compliance, that is the elasticity of the lungs, reduces when there is fibrosis and other things like obesity, kyphoscoliosis, pulmonary edema, and effusion. This is when the expansile property of the lung reduces. So this is a decreased compliance, and the slope also reduces, which means even if you increase a greater transpulmonary pressure is required to increase the volume of the lung as you take in a breath. On the other hand, the opposite happens when it is an emphysema, that is, the compliance increases beyond measure. So even with a small change in pressure, the lung volume increases quite a lot. The decrease in compliance leads to the increased work of breathing here. The other properties, apart from compliance of the lung, the other properties that help in maintenance of stability of the alveolar are the surfactant production in the lungs. The surfactant increases the compliance and lowers the elastic recoil to reduce the work of breathing. It helps to prevent the complete collapse of the alveolar and plays an important role in maintaining stability. So this is the second thing. The third point is the concept of alveolar interdependence. As we can see in the picture, any alveoli, there are in between the alveoli are connected together by the pores of Corn and the canals of Lambert. When the alveoli are collapsing, they are held together by traction forces from the other alveoli because of the pores of Corn and the canals of Lambert. This prevents the collapsing of the alveolus, and it is pulled open. So the alveoli act as a combined unit functionally. We finished the static properties and we mainly saw the compliance and where we also saw the pressure volume curve and the other properties that help in maintaining the stability of the alveoli. We'll move on to the dynamic properties of the lung, where the most important of all is the airway resistance. When we take a look at resistance, we must know the principles of the laminar and the turbulent flow in the airway. And we'll also see dynamic compliance and the work of breathing and the factors contributing to it. So from for air to move from the outside to the distal airways, there are three main opposing forces that need to be overcome: the elastic recoil of the lungs and the chest wall, the resistance of the airways, and the impedance of acceleration of the respiratory system. The most important force that needs to be overcome is point number two here, which is the frictional resistance. Which is a combined resistance of the airways, lung, and the chest wall. And out of these three resistances, the resistance offered by the airways is the largest contributor, because of which the frictional resistance of the airways is what needs to be overcome the most. And resistance is determined by the airflow in the lungs, because of which, the circle is supposed to be here. We will first look at the airflow and the types of airflow that happen. So air always flows from a point of high pressure to a point of low pressure. And the formula to remember when we think of airflow is velocity is equal to flow rate by cross-sectional area. Important thing to note is when the cross-sectional area is inversely proportional, which means as the cross-sectional area decreases, the velocity of flow will increase. So the patterns of airflow are first, there can be a laminar pattern which occurs in the low flow areas, which is mainly the smaller airways, where the stream of the flow is parallel to the walls of the tube. The second one is a transitional flow. This is usually when the airways divide further, small eddy currents occur, and this creates a disturbance. So this is called a transitional flow or a disturbed flow. The third one is a turbulent flow, which occurs mainly in the trachea because of a high velocity of the stream, where the particles move perpendicular and parallel to the axis of the tube. When we learn of airflow, Reynolds number is an important thing to know. When the Reynolds number is beyond 2000, the flow is said to be turbulent. Why is it so? Is the Reynolds number is given by this formula, where it is directly proportional to the radius and the average velocity, so and the density of the gas. So we just learned that in the trachea, the flow is turbulent, which means that, so why is the flow turbulent? The trachea has a large radius. As the radius increases, the Reynolds number increases. Also, the velocity is high in the trachea. So the Reynolds number is beyond 2000 in the trachea, which makes the flow turbulent. Whereas in the small airways, as we go further, the cross-sectional area, the collective cross-sectional area increases. And we know that the cross-sectional area is inversely proportional to the velocity. So as the collective cross-sectional area of the airway increases, the velocity reduces and the Reynolds number falls low, because of which the flow does not become turbulent in the smaller airways. So from the Reynolds number, we derive this, that the flow does not become turbulent in the smaller airways. So this is the density of the viscosity. This is a constant effort. It's a constant. Keeping Reynolds number in mind, we'll move on to the next equation that is very important for us, which is the Poiseuille's equation. And from the Poiseuille's equation, is why it is important is because resistance is derived from that formula. So change in pressure is directly proportional to the length, the flow rate, and inversely proportional to the radius. And resistance is the change in pressure divided by the flow rate. So the resistance formula comes to this, where the important point to note is that it is inversely proportional to the fourth power of the radius, which means that if the radius is reduced by half, the resistance will increase 16-fold. So though L is here, the radius of the tube is the main factor affecting the resistance. Considering this equation, actually, when the airway becomes smaller, because the radius reduces, the resistance should be greater of individual airways. But we see that in reality, as in physiologically, the airway resistance, which consists of the upper airway and the lower airway resistance, most of the resistance occurs in the upper airway. And then in the lower airway also, 20 to 40% of the resistance is taken up to the first eight generations, which means the resistance is very low towards the end. Why it is so is, how is the resistance reduced in the distal airways? As the velocity is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area, the collective cross-sectional area is greatly reduced as we go distally. And collective cross-sectional area is increased. It is increased, and which is inversely proportional to the velocity, because as the velocity decreases, the resistance also decreases. The second, so this is one thing responsible for the low resistance in the distal airways. The next thing that is important is that the airway resistance is taken in parallel towards the distal airways. When we take resistance in series, the individual resistances will add up. But what happens in the airways is, because it is parallel, the inverse of the resistances are added up, which comes to a very low collective number. So even if the resistance in small airways individually is very high, the total resistance may not really significantly increase. So this was the concept of resistance and how the lung maintains a low resistance even distally. The factors that affect the diameter will in fact change the resistance, because we saw the formula where it was inversely proportional to the fourth power of R. So when is the radius reduced or the diameter reduced is when there's a high mucus production, when there's edema, when there is contraction of the bronchial smooth muscles, and when the elastic recoil increases. The application for us here is mainly in asthma and obstructive airway disorders, where the radius is reduced and the resistance increases. The resistance has a neurohumeral regulation because it is surrounded totally by smooth muscles, and smooth muscles are under the control of the autonomic nervous system. The constriction occurs when there is parasympathetic stimulation through the vagus nerve, and dilatation occurs when there is sympathetic stimulation of the beta 2 receptors or adrenergic stimulation. Here, acetylcholine is involved. Other things which cause constrictions are the histamine release, leukotrienes, thromboxane A2, serotonin, and alpha adrenergic antagonist. Also, here there is nitric oxide. The level of carbon dioxide and the partial pressure of carbon dioxide and that of oxygen also plays a role in constriction and dilation. So, increased carbon dioxide will cause dilatation in the airways. And decreased oxygen partial pressure will also cause dilatation in the small airways. The next dynamic property we'll look at is the compliance. Just like static compliance, there is also dynamic compliance when the lung volume increases with time. Like we already saw, it is the distensibility of the lung. And the formula that we are given is the change in volume by the change in pressure. That is delta V by delta P. And this is the curve where this is the pleural pressure, which becomes more negative as you go to towards the x-axis, and the volume of the lung on the y-axis. So during inhalation, this curve ABC is the curve during inhalation. As we exhale, the CDA brings us back to the same pleural pressure. And the slope of the line joining the two is the dynamic compliance. So we see that the dynamic compliance reduces when we are inspiring and increases while we are exhaling. this is the dynamic hyperinflation is also related, is also because of the increase in the dynamic compliance in mainly seen in COPD. What happens is the after a full, usually mainly during exercise and when the tidal volume increases, after inspiration, the person is not able to completely exhale before the onset of the next breath. So this is inhalation, and before exhaling the next breath, exhaling fully, the next breath starts, and this process goes on, and the functional residual capacity keeps on increasing. Here is a normal functional residual capacity, and in COPD, because of increased compliance, the FRC goes on increasing till it finally reaches the total lung capacity. This is when there is hyperinflation and the diaphragm is pushed down, the ribs are also moved apart, and this creates a very the mechanical advantage which is usually there does not occur. So it creates fatigue of the muscles, where your work of breathing increases and leads to decompensation. This is usually the mechanism which happens when in COPD patients they decompensate. The cause is usually due to the reduced elastic recoil, that is the alveoli do not deflate back to the original size, and the loss of alveolar attachments and increased airway resistance. This is a graph showing the work of breathing. So this is the compliance graph, and the work of breathing is this entire area, which is given by the formula change in volume into the pressure exerted across the system. So as the graph, as the compliance decreases, if the graph shifts this way, the work of breathing will increase. But our body has the physiological tendency is to always minimize the work of breathing. We'll look at the first graph here. So this is the work of breathing, which is the, and this is the elastic resistance. This is the resistance in, for the airflow. So the work of breathing is the is minimal at the point of intersection of the two. So when the elastic resistance increases, like in fibrosis, this part, this line shifts up, and the point of intersection shifts further ahead. And this is the respiratory frequency which is which the person breathes at. So the work of breathing, the most minimal work of breathing will happen at a much higher respiratory rate, which is why when the resistance increases, the person will take shallow breaths, but more number of breaths. And the other way around, when the airflow actually, airflow resistance increases, the point of intersection shifts to the left, which means that the most minimal work of breathing will happen at a much lower respiratory rate. So the person takes deep and shallow breaths. These are the few properties that we saw. Summarizing the few things that we saw, in lung mechanics, we saw both static and dynamic dynamic properties of the lung. In static properties, we mainly saw the lung compliance, where we saw the pulmonary compliance and the chest wall compliance differently, and the total compliance and the graph, and the application of the compliance, which is the shift of the graph to the right or the left. We also saw the pressure volume curve, and the other things that maintain alveolar stability, which is a surfactant, and the alveolar interdependence. In the dynamic part, we saw the airflow, which was laminar or turbulent. The resistance mainly we looked at, which included the explanation of the Reynolds number, the Poiseuille's equation, the resistance in the different areas of the airway and how it becomes less distally, the factors affecting resistance, neurohumoral regulation, and dynamic hyperinflation. And to end with, we saw the concept of work of breathing.